Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon. Thanks for the organizing committee to give me the chance to participate in this event. So I have been given the task to give an overview of adrenal insufficiency in 20 minutes. Excuse me, I will take 24 minutes exactly. So I have nothing to disclose. I will try to cover a bit of history and physiology, and then I divide my presentation into three parts. And the first part will go through the diagnostic approach of patients with adrenal insufficiency through cases. And in the second part, we'll discuss a few points that are important around the evaluation of the adrenal corticoid function. And then we will end up with management. So to start with, Thomas Edison described in his adrenal section, he wrote, with perhaps a single exception, the disease in my own experience resisted all remedial efforts and sooner or later terminated fatally. And he meant by that patients who have adrenal insufficiency. Thanks to these three scientists who contributed to the discovery of steroid and saved humanity, not only patients with adrenal insufficiency, but also across other conditions in oncology and rheumatology. Now, adrenal glands basically consist of a core and cortex, and the core is the medulla, which is responsible for the secretion of catecholamines, while the adrenal cortex is divided into three layers. The outermost layer is zona glomerulosa, where its mineral corticoids are secreted. The innermost layer is the zona reticularis, where adrenal androgens, mainly dihydroepiandrosterone, are produced. And the layer in between is called zona vasculita, where cortisol is synthesized and secreted. Now, it's important to understand that the regulation of cortisol secretion is under the HPA axis, which is hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. So CRH secreted from the hypothalamus will stimulate the corticotroph cells in the anterior pituitary to produce the ACTH, which therefore will stimulate the adrenal to produce the cortisol. Cortisol has a negative feedback on both ACTH and CRH secretion. While the aldosterone secretion is under the RAS system regulation, only 10% of it is under the ACTH stimulation. Also, it produced in pulsatile form during the day. There are theoretically three types of adrenal insufficiency. However, clinically, they are mainly two. The first type is where the adrenal is the defect at the adrenal level. And in this type, which is called the primary adrenal insufficiency, there will be a decrease in the production of all types of steroids, including glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid, and adrenal androgens. And there will be loss of negative feedback of the cortisol on hypothalamus and on the pituitary, and therefore ACTH will be elevated. However, in both secondary and tertiary adrenal insufficiency, where the defect is at the pituitary and hypothalamus respectively, there will be only reduction in the production of both glucocorticoid and adrenal androgens. However, mineralocorticoid production will be preserved. Now, why we are talking about this important topic? Because there have been, at population epidemiological study, increase in the incidence of adrenal insufficiency. And this is mainly due to the increase of secondary, tertiary adrenal insufficiency, which is attributed to the increased use of exogenous steroids as well as opioids. Now, we will go through how to approach these cases through two examples. So our first case is basically a 32-year-old Asian male who presented to the ER with 8 days history of nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain, and 5 months history of poor oral intake and weight loss. His important history is significant only for his wife, who has been treated for TB a few years back in his home country. While the second case is a 53-year-old female who was referred to the clinic with a 4 months history of severe fatigue, tiredness, lying on the bed most of the time, no headache, no visual field defect, but has significant weight loss. It was impairing her life with inability to do homework, home-related work. Her past medical history, significant for breast cancer, for which she was treated with a new adjuvant chemo, followed by surgery. And after that, she was started a few months back on immune checkpoint inhibitor, pembrolizumab. She is also a known case of primary hypothyroidism on adequate thyroxine replacement. On physical examination, you could see that both cases have a bit of low blood pressure. However, the first case has low weight and BMI, and also had hyperpigmentation. Initial labs showed that the first patient was having severe hyponatremia with hyperkalemia. He had also elevated LFTs that I will discuss later, and his random evening serum cortisol was low, while the second case was having low normal sodium and her potassium was normal. So the clinical manifestation of adrenal insufficiency really it depends on which kind of steroids have been deficit. And in the case of patient with primary adrenal insufficiency, the three types of steroid will be lost, and therefore the patient will have a mix of these symptoms. While patient with secondary adrenal insufficiency will have only glucocorticoid and adrenal androgen deficiency. Remember that hyperpigmentation can only present in patient with primary adrenal insufficiency. Now, in this very important study that covered two registries from Norway and Sweden, they only addressed the manifestation and the presentation of patient with autoimmune Addison disease, who have all of them have autoantibodies 21 hydroxylase. The mean age was 36, and around 70% of these cases were only diagnosed during admission. That means there was a provoking factor for them to be diagnosed. Only a third of them had presented with adrenal crisis, and around 50% have other autoimmune disease diagnosed at the same time or later. Only 22% of them had low BMI, and around 40% have low systolic blood pressure. However, hyperpigmentation was present in the majority of patients. However, I want just to comment on hyperpigmentation. Remember, it depends on the duration of the adrenal insufficiency. If a primary adrenal insufficiency develops acutely, like in the case of a bleeding or thrombosis in the context of antiphospholipid syndrome, then there was no time for hyperpigmentation to develop, and this sign will be absent. Hyponatremia was present in almost 80% of the cases, while only a third of the cases have hyperkalemia. And therefore, the classic finding of hyponatremia and hyperkalemia was present only in a third of patients. Multi-SH elevation was present as well in 50% of cases. Hypoglycemia was uncommon, but as you remember, the mean age was here 36, so majority of these patients were adult. Hypoglycemia is more frequently found in pediatric patients. Something that's important for patient for internists is how much adrenal insufficiency contribute to the SIDH. And this is one of the well-conducted prospective study where they found that patients admitted with hyponatremia, almost 43.4% of them were related to SIDH. However, the most common cause was central nervous system, the most common cause for SIDH, central nervous system disease, pulmonary disease, malignancy, and the drugs. Adrenal insufficiency per se only responsible for around 3.8% of patients with SIDH. And most of these cases, almost all of them were attributed to secondary adrenal insufficiency, either from exogenous steroid use or from undiagnosed hypopituitarism. Now, once we suspect the patient to have adrenal insufficiency, we will check cortisol, preferably AM cortisol, unless the patient is admitted with a crisis, then you have just to draw cortisol level. And then make sure that the patient is not on exogenous steroid use, and then you check the ACTH. If the ACTH is elevated at least 2-fold the upper limit, along with the low AM cortisol, usually as per the guidelines, less than 140, based on the previous polyclonal assays, then the diagnosis is primary adrenal insufficiency. However, if the ACTH is normal or low in the context of low cortisol, then this goes with secondary adrenal insufficiency. So back to the cases, the first patient had highly elevated ACTH with a low baseline cortisol, which is justify the diagnosis of primary adrenal insufficiency. Also, he had failure to failure of response to ACTH stimulation, while the second case have low ACTH and low baseline cortisol. So after you diagnose the patient with the kind of adrenal insufficiency they have, like for example, in case one primary adrenal insufficiency, and we'll go with that part first, you have to look for the causative diagnosis. And the first thing to do is check 21 hydroxylase antibody, because autoimmune disease is one of the most common causes in developed countries. If it is positive, then you check for other autoimmune disease to ascertain if the patient has polyendocrinopathy or not. If 21 hydroxylase came back negative, then you have to do CT adrenal. And if CT adrenal is enlarged, then you go for another diagnostic pathway that we will discuss later. However, if it is normal and your patient is a male patient, then think of X-linked adrenal nuclear dystrophy, and therefore you need to send for very long fatty chain acid. In this table, the causes of other insufficiency are listed, and you can see that they range from autoimmune, infection, tumor, bleeding, surgery, genetic, and medication. Most of these medications are the ones that we used for treatment of Cushing's disease. Back to our case, actually, the patient had ultrasound in ER that showed heterogeneous hypoechoic lesion in the right suprarenal area. And this was followed by CT, which shows bilateral adrenal enlargement. So we have a patient with primary adrenal insufficiency and bilateral adrenal enlargement. So we have to think of infiltrative causes or of fungal infections, for example, or mycobacterium infection. And there is a role of adrenal biopsy in such cases after ruling out catecholamines secreting tumors. So adrenal biopsy in this patient, so necrotic granuloma, and this was studied with fungal spores that were consisting with histoplasmosis. Histoplasmosis is becoming a very common cause of primary adrenal insufficiency in the north of India. And in this single center study, they found that over the last few years, actually the histoplasmosis was the leading cause of primary adrenal insufficiency compared to TB and autoimmune disease. Now, moving to the second case, where goes with secondary adrenal insufficiency, then you need to check for other hormones and for MRI pituitary. Now, this is causes of secondary adrenal insufficiency, as you can see, include tumors, iatrogenic causes, autoimmune, genetic, infiltrative, and medication that include checkpoint inhibitors. Our patient was in pembrolizumab, which is anti-PD-1 in antibodies, though hypophysitis is more common with anti-CLA4 antibodies. However, it is still reported in anti-PD-1. And we are commonly encountered with isolated ACTH deficiency, not in the context of hypophysitis classic 1. Now, this is algorithmic diagnosis, but remember these cutoff values of cortisol based on older assays, and the values could be lower with the newer assay. Now we'll move to the second part, which is evaluation of adrenal corticoid function. The first question is, what is the morning cortisol that predicts the SST outcome? In this multicentric study with a huge number of SST using different types of assay and different cutoff of success definition with SST, you could see that the morning cortisol level that predict the 100% the pass of SST was ranging from 336 to 506 based on the assay. However, other studies showed also that the level not just depends on the type of assay, also on the possible underlying cause. And you can see that here it ranges from 300 to 376 based if the patient was having SST based on suspicion of primary adrenal insufficiency or due to glucocorticoid-induced adrenal insufficiency or to secondary adrenal insufficiency. Other possible causes that make the morning cortisol level variable as a predictor of SST response is the settings of the SST. So several studies have tried to study this, different assays, different timing, and different underlying cause. So the first answer for the first question, really it depends on the assay type and the setting, timing, and underlying etiology. The second question is really, what is the peak response that is considered normal? And remember, before we were using lots of polyclonal antibody that has cross-reactivity. However, the new generation's assay are more accurate and specific. And in fact, recent study has showed that they have excellent correlation with the older assay. Here we have cortisol Roche-2, we have AXIS and LCMS. And the older assay was Roche-1. There was a very good correlation between all of them with the older assay. However, the cortisol level that correspond with the appropriate passing of SST was 22 to 39% lower. And therefore, the new cortisol response to SST actually should be between 386 to 414, much lower than the previous cutoff. Again, in this study also, they found the 60-minute cortisol level was actually higher than the 30-minute across all the newer assays. Another thing, they could not figure out the morning cortisol that predict the success. So the peak cortisol, there is good correlation between the newer assays and the older one. The new cortisol response is lower, and the 60-minute cortisol is higher than the 30. What about a new screening assay? In this study, they found that the walking salivary cortisone was a very good test for screening for adrenal insufficiency compared to baseline serum cortisol and even to baseline serum cortisol either measured by immunoassay or LC-MS. This study needs further validation. However, it is a good future tool for screening for adrenal insufficiency. Now, the dynamic tests that we used also in secondary insufficiency include insulin tolerance test, which is less used nowadays, ACTH with the lower dose, 1 mic, metabolic stimulation test, and the glucagon stimulation test, which I will not go further with. And then we'll move to the last part, which is the management. So treatment of adrenal insufficiency depends on the type. If you are speaking about a primary adrenal insufficiency, we need to replace with the glucocorticoid and the mineralocorticoid. Glucocorticoid replacement either with hydrocortisone immediate release or prednisolone or hydrocortisone modified release or cortisone acetate tablets, which are not available here. Fludrocortisone usually in the range doses between 0.05 to 2 milligram once daily. Adrenal androgen replacement in women only if they have low energy, depression, or low libido. And again, you have to look for side effects profile development like hirsutism and acne. Personally, I have never used it. In patients with secondary adrenal insufficiency, you will need only to replace with the glucocorticoid and if needed, adrenal androgen, dihydropy androstenedione. However, usually the hydrocortisone doses are lower than the case of primary adrenal insufficiency because many of these patients have partial adrenal insufficiency. Now, what is better to be replaced with? In this study, they found that bilinodrine, which is the hydrocortisone double-releasing tablets, are having a better metabolic profile in terms of hemoglobin A1C and weight compared to the immediate-release hydrocortisone. Remember, bilinodrine is double-release. It has a core and it has outer layer. The outer layer will release immediate-release hydrocortisone, and the core will release extended-release hydrocortisone. It is given once daily. It is approved by EMA for adrenal insufficiency. However, it is quite expensive compared to the immediate release. Another example is prednisolone, where some study found that prednisolone is associated with a higher or a worse libido profile compared to the immediate release hydrocortisone. However, you can see in this study, they used the higher dose 5 milligram. Others have shown that using lower doses, 3 to 4 milligram, is actually have similar cardiovascular profile to the immediate hydrocortisone. For the adrenal crisis management, briefly, you will need to replace the patient with hydrocortisone, 100 milligram bolus followed by infusion, or you give intravenous or intramuscular 50 milligram every 6 hours, and the fluid replacement and the treatment the underlying causative. Why we are concerning with intravenous infusion continuously? Because in this study, well designed, they found or they looked to the cortisol level in patients, the healthy volunteer, under several stressful conditions. And the mean cortisol level was around 800. Once they tried several forms of replacement, they found that continuous infusion is associated with achievement and constant achievement of the same level of cortisol that's seen in healthy volunteer. Remember to teach the patient about sick day rules. What they have to do is doubling or tripling the doses in the moderate intercurrent illness. In the severe cases, to use parenteral hydrocortisone, they can administer it subcut. There are videos available in YouTube. You could share it with your patient to learn how to administer it at home. So future prospect, the current treatment is basically not curative. It is just replacement. We are trying to mimic the circadian rhythm with our best. However, future is looking for a more options to do better and not only cover circadian rhythm, but also ultradian variation. We need well-designed double-blind randomized trial to compare the recent or the current medication regimen. I think there is already one trial register comparing bilinodrine with another form of modified release hydrocortisone called Coronotrop, which is only approved for patients with CAH. Adrenal cortical cell or gene therapy is a future for patients with adrenal primary adrenal insufficiency. Thank you for your listening, and I am on time.